everything that we can, just as you guys are doing right now. Now, this morning, it is what? Kids Sunday. I'm really glad, Pastor, that you would move these candies out here, because I tell you, you're not going to make it. I'm going to knock them over. I wouldn't eat them. But I'm very excited to be here at the Peninsula Baptist Church, and I really do feel like you missed an opportunity right there, because it's so close to PB&J. I just don't know how you could work that one in right there. Maybe a ministry, the Peninsula Baptist. Anybody got
me? Joyful?
The Peninsula Baptist. Maybe that's like the name of a ladies' quartet or something. The Peninsula Baptist Joyful.
Jubilee.
Like that. The PB&Js. We'll work on it. Now, I'm very excited this morning to be here this morning to preach for you all. And just as Pastor Whitehouse has said, that's why God created me. And so in 2001, my mother passed. And upon coming back from her funeral in California, I went to an altar call at a missions conference. And that preacher, he got up and said, "Is there a king in me?" And I said, "Ooh, is there a king in me?" And I got fired up. He was talking about how the Navy SEALs are an elite group of warriors that go out and do this, and we can be the exact same way. And I rushed down to that altar, and I brought my family, and I said, "Listen, family," and I said, "Lord, I'm yielding myself, and I'm yielding my family right now to preach your word. I don't know what that means. I don't know what it's going, but all I know is this, Lord, I want to do this, and I want to do it for you." And sometimes what that means is your kid's going to, you promise your kid, and you say, "Hey, we're going to go fishing today. We're going to go fishing today." And man, you want to go out, and you're talking about, we're going to knock the rust off the poles, and we're going to go out, and we're going to spend some time together, and it's going to be awesome. But then there's also the ministry. You got to be able to take care of that too. And so sometimes you have to look your kid in the face if you've been called, and you have to say, "I'm sorry. I'm sorry, but I have to stay home, and I have to prepare this. I have to get this ready. Because number one, God has called me to preach. And number two, the people need to hear. It's not something that would take lightly. It's not something that would take lightly." But I do want to say thank you, Pastor Whitehouse, for sharing your pulpit with me every time I come up here. Man, I love this thing right here. This is nice. And thank you, congregation, for being here and simply making time for God. You know, there's a whole lot of things that you could be doing right now. You could be at IHOP, you could be in bed, you could be going to buy a new car, who knows? But you're here, and you're making time for God, and God's looking down, and He's smiling, He is pleased that you're here. And I want to say thank you, children. Thank you, children, for being children. Amen. So let me tell you, if the kids get rowdy, if this one jumps and he smacks his head and he's screaming his head off, guess what? This is Kids Sunday. This is the one Sunday where they're not going to be in the nursery and they're going to be in here. And remember, it's kind of like a cloudy, rainy, stormy day. Well, you got to have that in order to appreciate beautiful sunny ones like today. And so you got to crack a couple eggs to make an omelet. I mean, we can go on and on with all sorts of things we can say. But hey, remember this. Ladies, if you're volunteering your time over there, your service to God, man, you're doing a great work for the Lord, because you're freeing this up for the people to hear God's word preached.
Amen.
Okay, I know you ladies go through the tribulation period every time you're over there. It's tough. I get it. But you're doing a great work. Please keep it up. And if you wanted to, maybe you wanted to do a little bit more for your church, go talk to your pastor and say, "Pastor, maybe, you know, the lady right there, and I'd like to maybe go into the nursery. Is there something that I can do?" And there's always something for everybody to do, right?
Man.
Now, I just read this report. Scientists have just discovered that the child's ear is the most delicate instrument in the world. It can somehow not hear the shout of a parent in the next room, yet can pick up the faintest tingle of the ice cream man's jingle. I can testify to that, because every time, Brody, every time I go and I'm sneaking into the kitchen and I pull open, that freezer, and what am I grabbing? Oh yeah, Daddy's grabbing a drumstick. Daddy's grabbing a little bit of ice cream, all without fail. One of my kids is coming in. "Hey, Dad, what are you doing?" You know what Dad's doing. Dad's sneaking a little bit of ice cream. Man, now honestly, children really do brighten up. They do. They absolutely do. They are always leaving the lights on. Dad's right there. They are, right? Yeah. Children, I read this quote yesterday, and I put it in here because I just simply wanted to share it with you. And it's this: children brought up in Sunday school are seldom brought up in court. Amen to that. I can testify I was not brought up in Sunday school. And I've been to court. And I'll tell you, if I had a daddy, and if I went to church, and if I stayed in that church, I tell you, I guarantee you, I wouldn't have led the life that I did. And it was a lot of arguing. It was a lot of troubles, kiddos. Stay in church and be obedient unto your parents. It's going to be a blessing to you. Parents, let's strive, and let's do the best that we can to be Christ-like in all that we do, especially when we're leading our families right. Kids Sunday. I don't ever want to approach the Bible with something in mind. Well, it's Kids Sunday, so, you know, I'm going to, you know, and then pull something out of that. I want to go to God, and I want to go to the Bible, and I want for that to be where I start, not with my own idea. So I went and I prayed to God. And so the word, okay, kid. And so I'm like, cool, kid. Let me just type it into my little Bible app here, kid. I'll pull the verse out right there and find it. Well, 43 times it shows up in the Bible. Guess what? 42 of those are in the Old Testament. And guess what? Of those 42 times, how many times do you think they're referring to kids, like children? Zero. Big old goose egg. It's always talking about killing a kid, a goat kid.
It's Jerry.
Jumped. I'm sorry right there. And this is exactly why I'm telling you the story. I searched kid, King James Bible, 43 times. It's actually the sacrifice of a kid. Or if his sin, wherein he has sinned, come to his knowledge, he shall bring his offering. A kid of the goats, a male without blemish, and he shall lay his hand upon the head of the goat and kill him. Okay, so I was thinking, that's not really going to work for Kids Sunday. Yes, Arabelle shaking your head. How could you? So the search continues. And so the search went on, and I prayed again out of my head. I said, Lord, it's not going to work. Can you give me something else? Child. Oh, there we go. There's a good one. And so I searched child. And I typed it in. Child or children, 183 times it showed up in the King James Bible. I thought, okay, I got a lot to work with here. What am I going to do? Oof. So we find ourselves this morning looking at the instructions to children. Amen. Amen. Instructions to children. I'm preaching to kids. But don't get too excited, parents. I'm going to be preaching to y'all as well because there's a lot to do with the raising of kids. So I don't think you're getting off right there.
Right.
Now, Ephesians chapter 6. If you start making your way towards Ephesians chapter 6, and we'll just be in the first four verses. And what we're going to do is when you get there, go ahead and stand. And kids, when you get there, please shout a nice loud amen. Kids, teach these adults a thing or two. Come on.
Amen.
When you get there, kiddos,
amen.
And you're standing and you find Ephesians chapter 6, you just go ahead and give me a big old
amen.
Woo. Woo. I think I heard one.
Kid?
Amen.
Was that a kid?
No.
That was her.
Sounded like a kid. Amen. Great job. And listen, I'm sorry. I am absolutely going past four times a day. Anybody got to be anywhere today? Praise the Lord for it. Ephesians chapter 6, 1 through 4. We're going to go ahead and read responsibly. That is, I'll start us out and we'll read every other together. Amen. All right, so chapter 6, verse 1. And then we're going to read all the way to verse 4, every other together. I'll start us out. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. All together.
Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise.
That it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live long on the earth. And ye fathers,
provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord.
Praise God. Here we find instructions in God's word to children, to the parents. We find instructions to the Christian. Title of our message this morning, instructions in parenting and childing. Dear Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for this message. I would just ask that now we would sink in to your word. We fire our teeth into it, Lord. We let down the gates of our eyes and our ears and our heart. We let your word come in and do what it does best. Lord, thank you for the children of this church, and thank you for the adults as well. Just godly parents, people who are raising the next generation up, Lord, such a dark and trying time that we have. Lord, we know we have hope. We know we can be thankful, and we know we can have joy even in such a time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Now, last Sunday school, does anybody remember what we talked about last Sunday? It was the book of Ephesians. And that's exactly where we are today. Now, the theme of Ephesians, if there was just one thing, if I could dream, and I could imagine, and I could hope for anything to have been learned and retained unto this day, it would be that you remember the theme. Now the theme, number one, was that believers consist of the body of Christ. And then that number two, Jesus has made the Jew and the Gentile into one man. That man is the Christian. Jesus has made the Jew, and Jesus has made the Gentile, that broken down wall of partition that would, you know, now both and all have been made into one new person, one new man. And we're all in that man, we're all Christian. And so remember, the book of Ephesians is all about that. That's the entire theme of it. Now, the scripture we are in today resides in God's word in the book that has the theme of believers in unity, a unity brought forth by Jesus Christ, But we do not necessarily understand this, and we don't have to understand the theme in order to get to the truth that we just read in chapter 6. But it does all go together. It does all go together. It's in the same book. It's in the same theme. Okay? Believers are the body of Christ, and as such, we're all made part of the entire same body. There could be no closer relationship between us, between believers. We're of the same body, this hand and this hand. Yes, they're different, but we're all the same body. We're all the same body. We're made the same body because of Jesus Christ. Now, within the church, even this very church we are in now, Peninsula Baptist Church, 2024, the year of our Lord, there is within the church a unity and a growth that should be followed.
Amen.
All of this is according to God's word. And Paul lays it out for us. That's where we get doctrines. That's where we get teachings. And that's how we do that. Now, chapters 4 through 6 of Ephesians, all right? Let me get it to you right there. Paul exhorts the New Testament church to keep the unity of the Spirit, right? Not just a union amongst them, you know, but actual unity with the believers. Bringing them all together and saying, you know, there is no more difference between us, all right? We're all made the same man. We're the same body because of Jesus Christ. Now, praise God. He tells them this is how the church is to walk. This is what is expected of you. This is how we should conduct ourselves, church. This is the exact way that I want you to be. This is God working through Paul to pen this down throughout all of the ages.
Amen.
All for us, because we weren't around 2,000 years ago when this was penned. All right, but we still abide by it. God gave us his word. God gave us these instructions, and this is what we are to follow.
Amen.
Praise God. This is how we are to walk church.
Amen.
He's talking to what church? The church at Ephesus, the church in the regions of Ephesus. And he wrote it down for them. He wrote it down for you. He wrote it down for us even now. Now, he goes into the unity and the growth of the church. Unity and growth of the church, of us, of this, what we have here. Now, containing both the Jew and the Gentile, that it's all to be in harmony, Paul goes on in chapters 4 and 6 to describe the conduct and the character of the church, the relationship of the believer with the non-believer, and finally, the Christian with the Christian. So, we have exactly how the church is to be, how the Christian is to be with the non-believers, and how the Christian is to be with the other Christians. That's what he's laying out for us in chapters 4 and 6 of Ephesians. This is that block. This is that context. That's where we are at. That's what we're looking at. And located within that, that's what we just read, and we're going to get to it. Let's understand where we're at. Now, this leads us to Paul describing the conduct and the character of Christians to one another. He brings up things of unity, of peace, our walk with Christ, our own personal growth, harmony amongst the church, the conduct of the church, the character of the church, the very conduct and character of the Christian to the unbelieving world as we go out. He says this is how we are to be with that unbelieving world. When we go out soul winning, we're going out to the store, whatever it is, this is how we are to be, this is how we are to act, this is how we're to be, this is how we're to act. Okay, church?
Amen.
But finally, the conduct and character of the Christians to other Christians. Yes, within Ephesus and within the region of Ephesus and this church to this church and this believer and this Christian to this Christian, but there's other churches, you know, and they're sending letters and they're talking amongst themselves. So this is how a Christian This is how the church at Ephesus is to talk with the church at Philippi, at Corinth. And this is all being discussed. Paul is just laying it out for everybody right here. Now, that leads us to Ephesians chapter 6. And now we kind of understand that backstory. We understand that context of where we're at. Ephesians chapter 6. Now, we don't just show up to this verse. Look at verse 1. We don't just show up to children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. We're talking about Christians and Christians. All right? We don't just show up here. But it actually goes back. So if you turn your Bibles back with me to chapter 5, and you look at verse 22, look at this. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. Am I right? Let's close up our Bibles and let's go ahead and head on home. Am I right, Brother Mike? Like, that's enough for today. That's all we need. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands.
Amen.
As unto the Lord. I wish it would be that. No, it's not. Let's go ahead and keep on reading. Verse 22, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. And so as we submit that submission, wives, it's not because your husband is just simply a man. No, it's because he is the authority. He is the head of the house. And so you submit yourselves just as you would submit yourselves unto the Lord. Now, let's keep going.
All right.
It goes all the way up through verse 24. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in every single thing. All right, so praise God for a godly wife. Amen. Praise God for a godly mother. Praise God for a godly woman in the house.
Amen.
Amen. Shout amen, and we can move on. Verse 25, husbands, love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and amen. Gave himself for it. Now stop right there. Hey, husbands. Hey, look up here, husbands. Love your wives. Man, it's so easy to preach, it's so easy to say, but it is a whole other story. After you go out into the world and you work a full-time job, you got up at 6 o'clock, you had to beat the traffic, you're trying to find the coffee, you got to work, you got to deal with worldly men inside of your job, you come home and you're beat and you're tired and you don't necessarily want to love your wife, all right? You just say, I just want my dinner, get the kids away from me, I'm stressed out, I'm all afraid, I need some time, okay? I need some time. That's not Christian. That's not manly. That's not what a husband is. That's not what the Bible says. Husbands, love your wives. Love is a choice, and love is hard. Love is something that we are to do. And so when we come home, you need to leave that at the door. You know, God gave you big shoulders, man. Why? So that way you can bear your burdens. Man. And you leave that stuff out into the world, and you deal with it out there. And when you come home, you be that. You be just like Christ in the home. You need to be a picture of Christ in your own home, all right? And when you do that, now the wife can look at you, and now the wife is going to respect you. And then when the wife starts respecting you, guess what? The kids start respecting you. And now you actually have biblical authority in your own home that you've earned. Yes, you can just have it granted to you. Yeah, sure, the Bible says that. But guess what? When your wife actually follows you, and the kids actually follow you, not just because they're supposed to, not just with their hands, but with their actual very hearts. Man, you make a big old difference, right? Man, that is a Christian home. That is the way that God is. And they call it a little slice of heaven, that marriage where, man, there's a harmony. There is a beautiful unity between you and the kids. Woo! That is good.
Man.
I feel sad for the world. Man, I feel sad for the world. When they go home after school and the kids get on their phones and they get on their video games and the husband is off in his own office doing his own thing, the wife's just off on her phone doing her own thing. And let me tell you, I work inside of people's homes for a living. I see it all the time. Even some of these big, giant, bigger than this building. I've been in 10,000 square foot, $1 million mansions. And the husband's got this section, and the wife's got that section. The kids got the whole upstairs, and there's 8 of them. There's no unity. There's no love. They're shouting at each other if they're talking to each other. I've just never seen a beautiful, great Christian. Very, very rarely have I seen it said. I feel so sad. I feel so bad. I feel so terrible for the world that they have to live in. Husbands, can we take some time? Can we take some time to show our ladies some love?
Man.
You come home, and I know you work with your hands. I know you build turbos, and you work on cars, and you change the oil out on 747s all day. I know you're a man. You're busy. I get it. Man, your hands. You come home, and your hands are tired. Take those hands. 5 minutes, just rub your wife's back, rub her feet, let her know that you care a little bit. And you don't want to, I get it, but let me tell you, it means a world of a difference to
sure
her.
Does.
I'll tell you what. Now, as Jesus loved the church and died for it, can't we make some sacrifices?
Amen.
Man, I'm tired. I worked all day. Get over yourself.
Amen.
Get over yourself. Be like Christ, sacrifice. But I worked all day. She did too. In her complementary God-given role. You know, the woman is not to go out and do what you do, man. That's why God made you different.
Amen.
We have complementary roles.
Amen.
We're equal, yes, but we have different roles that God has endowed upon us. He made our bodies a little bit different. All right, so man, we're going to go out there. We're going to be strong. We're going to work a job, and we're going to bring home the bacon. And the mama, she's been home all day. She's been taking care of the kids. And I've done it. I've taken care of my kids for a whole day. And let me tell you, it is hard work. You just want to... No, you don't. It's hard. It is absolutely hard work. And so when you come home and the wife, and you know, they say, hey, just take the kids for 20 minutes. I need 20 minutes. Have a little bit of a little bit of compassion in your heart to say, you know what? I'm going to take care of you right there today. Why don't you go out and get some coffee, call your sister up, go out. I got the kids. And then you lock them in the room. Who's got kids in here? Man, I'm kidding. I'm not going to lock kids in the room. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 33. Go there with me. It's the last verse of chapter 5. Sums it all up right here. Look at this. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself. No man loved him hated himself, you know, love your wife just like you love yourself. And so sometimes we can get a little greedy, man. We go to the 7-Eleven and we buy ourselves a $10 bag of jerky. And then we come home and the wife's like, you know, we're kind of low on groceries. I haven't had anything that I wanted today. And then you look back and you're like, oh man, I just spent 10 bucks on jerky and I didn't even think about buying my wife something that she likes. You know, it slips us and we don't love our wives like we love ourselves. We're selfish.
Amen.
We're sinners. We're human. Especially us men. That's hard to hear. That's hard to hear. But it's true. Now look at this. We're going to keep on going. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself. And the wife see that she reverence her husband. And that is right there. That's some hard preaching. When people talk about hard preaching, well, okay. Love your wife like you love yourself. And wives, reverence your husband.
Amen.
Man, what does that mean? Okay. Well, when your husband says something, don't undermine him. When your husband asks for a little bit of respect in the house, back me up a little bit with the kids or you know, whatever it is in that sense, just simply do it. You know? But he doesn't deserve it, that low-down dog. He doesn't. Give him a chance. Show him a little bit of respect and then see what happens when you submit to your husband and watch what happens when your husband submits back to you. You start to see that joy within your home. It's a beautiful thing. I mean, there's no other way to live, right? It's the best way to live. Oh. Now, the stage has been set. We see all this. We saw the context of Ephesians about how Paul is writing with this theme about unity within the church, and we see how the church is to act to the world. We see how the believers are to act in the world. We see how the Christians are to act with other Christians. We see right here how we have wives that are supposed to submit to their husbands, and we see husbands are supposed to love their wives even as they love themselves. We see this now. We have the wives that are reverencing their husbands. We have the husbands who are now loving their wives. And what is the next thing that Paul addresses? Chapter 6. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And so we see this progression. We can also look at this progression. You know, it starts out in Ephesians where he's talking about don't be a fool. He talks about this isn't just some normal ways in which we can learn doctrine in the first two chapters. And then for the rest of the chapters, it's all practical application. This is how we're going to be carrying ourselves. And then there's this progression of this is how you're to be. Like, get these things nailed down. Then comes marriage. Then comes the kids. And so that's what we're just simply seeing right here in chapter 6 is that further progression in Ephesians of just simply how we are to be the Christian walk through our entire lives. Paul addresses, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Now let's unpack that word obey for just a few minutes, because it's super. Now it's so easy. It is very easy for me to get up here and just say, whoo, obey what you read in the Bible. Obey your parents. That's easy preaching. It's easy to say something like that, but it's hard to do.
Amen.
Amen. It's hard to do. And in Christianity, and I'm sure if I were to go to this room and ask you, do you know what you're supposed to do? You're going to say what?
In the Bible.
You're going to say, yes, I know what I should do. I know that I should be obedient in X, Y, Z. It's not that I don't know what to do. It's not that I don't know right and wrong. It's that I can't do it. It's that I choose not to. It's that it's hard to do it. There's absolutely something that each and every one of us can say right now. There's something that I know I should be doing, that I should be obedient in, and that I am not doing. And if you are not that self-aware, there is something. Ask a friend. Ask your wife. Ask your pastor. Ask somebody, because I guarantee you, you're not perfect. There's something that each and every one of us can be working on right now. Right now. We can be obedient in something right now. Now think about this. We're unpacking obedience. Obedience must be defined so that we know what we're talking about. Now, let me tell you that it's not simply just doing what you're told. Obedience is not just simply go do this, and then you go and you do this thing, and then you come back and you say, I did this. That's not true obedience. Now, there is a man, his name is John Stormer, and he wrote a book. It's called Growing Up God's Way. And he gives this explanation of obedience. And I'm going to read it for you. Obedience is doing what those in authority request or want, period. Okay, that's good. There's some other things that are going to be in here, right? It is the opposite of doing your own thing. True obedience involves doing what an authority wants immediately, respectfully, joyfully, and completely. Say that with me. Immediately, respectfully, joyfully, and completely. Those four things. Take all of obedience, and all four of these points of obedience need to be met for it to be true obedience, real obedience. And the quote goes on, Christ. True obedience ultimately stems from submission to God.
Amen.
True obedience involves obeying. Number one, immediately. Number two, respectfully. Number three, joyfully. And number four, completely. You take any one of these things out of true obedience, and it's not true obedience. It's partial obedience. And we know partial obedience is full disobedience. Mm-hmm. Now look at this. Immediately. What does that mean? Well, I tell my son, go take out the trash. And then he waits an hour. And then he takes out the trash. Is he obedient?
No.
No. Because when we are to be obedient, we are to do it right away. So you read your Bible and you come across a little, you know, verse or something, and it kind of is like God just threw a javelin. And it gets you right in the heart. Oh, I should go soul winning. Yes. And as soon as you find out that you're supposed to go soul winning, as soon as you decide not to do it or to delay it, being disobedient to God. And disobedience to God, what is that? It's a three-letter word.
Sin.
Man. Sin is wrong. And so let me tell you this. Let me make it aware to every one of you right now. We are called, each and every one of us, to be a soldier.
Man.
Just as every Marine is a rifleman, every sailor is a fireman, every airman is a what? Parachuter? Make something.
I don't know what it is.
Just as every airman is a, who knows?
A chairman.
A chairman? Yeah, the chair for us. Just as every Christian is to be a soldier.
Amen.
The exact same. Every single one of us is. Now you've been made aware. Are you going to be obedient? True obedience involves obeying. Number one, immediately. Obey right away. Number two, respectfully. All right, children. Okay. Now I'm speaking to children. I'm speaking to adults. And really, we're all children. All right, respectfully. What does that mean? To be respectful with somebody. Be respectful with somebody. With a reverence to that person who has the authority. Amen. And so if I tell my son, go take out the trash. And he does not, he does it. He goes immediately and he does it. Yet he doesn't have a reverence for the authority which told him to do it. Meaning that he has a problem in his heart with doing it. Now we have a problem. Now we have an issue. Because he might be following me. He might be obeying. He might be doing it. But he's not going to be doing it with his whole heart. He's not going to be doing it with a good attitude. So when we do, when we have obedience, the respect comes in. And that has to be a part of true obedience. We have to have a respect or a reverence, or an honoring of the authority figure that is calling us or telling us to do something.
Amen.
So number one, immediately, do it right away. Number two, do it respectfully. In a word, honor. Have honor for that. Now, there's also number three in this one. Woo! Joyfully. And so when I tell my son, take out the trash, I'm hitting on you hard right now, Brody. You know, he does it right away. And he does it with some respect. He goes, yes, sir. And he runs and he grabs it and he goes. But he doesn't do it joyfully. You know, as soon as he gets that bag and he walks out the door, why do I have to do this? It's just ridiculous. Slam dunks that thing in there. And that's not joyful.
Man.
That's not obedience. That's not true obedience. Because now what he's doing is he's obeying me, just as the husbands and the wives, same thing. He's obeying me in his hands. He's obeying me in his actions. But he's not obeying me in his heart because I don't have his heart. Because as he is... he's doing this thing. He has this part, this hole inside of him. He's saying, why do I have to do this? My dad doesn't love me and there's no joy in it. But let me tell you, the secret ingredient in life is to do everything joyfully. To do everything with joy. But I gotta clean the head. I have to go and I have to do the dirtiest job on the site. I have to deal with this guy's problems that he left for me. And I've got all of this mess now. And so I can have that kind of attitude. And you can too. But man, let me tell you, as soon as you figure out in your mind, and you flip that switch and you say, I'm going to have joy in this. I'm going to have joy in cleaning up the bathroom. I'm going to have joy in opening up the church. I'm going to have joy in reading the Bible. I'm going to have joy in following and submitting Christ. I'm going to have joy in every single thing that I do. Man, it's like a key. It's that secret ingredient of life. And as soon as you start to do that and you learn about your countenance and how you can smile and you can say, I'm just going to do it. Woo! Man, it makes a huge difference in your life. I promise you, it's going to make a huge difference in your life. It's your attitude.
Man.
Do it with joy. Have a good attitude about it. But I don't want to do it. Everything that we do, we are to not do unto men. We are to do it unto the Lord.
Man.
Unto the Lord. We're not doing it to men. Now I know what that is. True obedience involves obeying immediately, right away. Respectfully, there's a reverence with the authority that's telling you to do it. And joyfully, that secret ingredient, do it with a smile. Man, do it with a smile. But lastly, complete. You've got to do the job completely. If I say, Brody, take out the trash. Yes, sir. Runs over there, picks it up, goes outside. He goes, he opens the thing, and then he sets it down right there, and he doesn't slam dunk it in. Oof. Well, you didn't do what I asked you to do. You didn't do it completely, and now we have an issue, because that's not complete obedience. And what is partial obedience? He did three of the four. He did, what is that called? Partial obedience is full disobedience. Man, you guys are good. Full disobedience, and that's not a good thing right there. Now, we know that true obedience is going to be obeying right away, having respect, doing it with a smile joyfully, and then completing the job fully. And you know what fully means. You know that you're supposed to be doing the entirety of what is required of you, what you're asking.
Amen.
Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. In the Lord. Well, what is that? Well, when you obey, children, when you obey, obey because you are being commanded by your authority. Even if they are not Christian parents, but always, always, always ensure this, children, that what you're obeying in is in line with the Word of God, with His commandments, with His teachings, with His instructions. Ephesians chapter 6, we'll go on. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Verse 2, honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. Honor means, right there, to have some respect. Have some respect, some inward reverence for that authority. Have some esteem for them. The difference comes in the hands and the heart. We cover that. We can simply follow, and then we can follow with our hands and hearts, and the inside, and true obedience.
Amen.
Now, you can get your child to obey. That's hard right there. Well, it says this. Which is the first commandment with promise? Which is the first commandment with promise? What is the promise that it's speaking? Well, Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. I'll read it for you. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. All right? Now, some people are going to take that verse, and this is what I couldn't find. This is what I couldn't get behind. They're going to say, when you honor your father and your mother, you're going to live long on the earth, and you're going to have prosperity. Well, that second part, the prosperity, as I read the scriptures, I couldn't find it, so I'm not going to preach it. I'm not going to say that, but it does say that we're going to live long on the earth. Okay, I can get on board with that. The promise is when we obey in love, in our hands and hearts, towards our parents, in their lawful commandments, then we will be blessed with a long life. Do I want to live a long life? As I've had kids and as I've gotten older, yes, I do. I want to live somewhere into my 80s. I think after that, I mean, I don't know, there's some preachers in their 90s that still... Tom Wallace, 92, 93, he's still getting up here and preaching. Woo! I want to do that maybe someday. But as I get older, I want to see my kids get married. I want to see their kids. I want to see my grandbabies. I want to see my grand-grandbabies. I think that's right. And I just want to live as long as I can. And then one day, yeah, when I pass into eternity, just as you're going to pass into eternity, it's going to be great. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be grand. But there is work for us to do here. And I want to reach people, and I want to do as much as I can for the Lord now while we can. Because once we pass into eternity, and once we're in heaven, we're not going to be able to do the things that we can do now. We can't reach the people. We can't do that when we're up there. We can't do it.
Amen.
All right. Now, what are some ways? All right, look at this. How can we do that? How can we honor our mother and our father? How can we do it? I wrote a couple of them down. Listen to this. Show our parents honor in our conduct, the things in which we do. We can be obedient to their lawful commands. That we can come when they call us. We can go where they send us. We can do what they bid us. We can refrain from what they forbid us. We can do it with a cheerful heart. We can submit to their corrections. As parents get older, we can take care of them, make old age easy for our parents, maintain them in their older years, and through all of this, the Lord is going to bless us, bless you, with long life. That's the promise. Now, Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4, this is where it all kind of comes together. I like this a lot. You know, we've looked at the children, and they have this focus right here on fathers. Father's Day is coming up. It's the most important day of the year. Next week. Praise God. And you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Stop. And you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Fathers can provoke their children to wrath by being hypocritical. Yeah. Parents, that is the number one thing. They're going to sniff it out a mile away. They're going to see daddy acting one way at home, and then they're going to see daddy acting another way at church. They're going to see daddy acting one way at work. They're going to see daddy acting a whole other way at the supermarket. But it is our job, parents. It's our job, especially dads. Remember, you're supposed to be Christ-like. You're supposed to be the head of the house, and when your children look at you, man, you can mess up, you can be hypocritical, and you can ruin that testimony for them.
Amen.
Do not provoke your children to wrath by being hypocritical. It's very easy for a father, praise God, it is very easy for us, man, to turn into a silverback gorilla like that.
Oh. So you just go, when you get mad,
right? We don't want to let those emotions control us.
Amen.
It's not masculine. It's not. It's a perversion of what God has put inside of you as a protector. Okay? And so when you feel that coming in, you need to have that. You know, be angry, but sin not. Use that emotion. That's fine, but do not sin in it. Do not get so angry to where you're doing things that are going to ruin your testimony, especially the testimony of Christ to your children.
Amen.
It's not right, but it's something that we work on. We're in perfect agreement. Fathers, husbands, sons, let's work on this. Injustice. We have injustice. Okay, so what does that mean? Dads, living one way at church and another way at home.
Yeah.
Okay, let's work on this. Losing our temper. We turn into that silverback gorilla. Urgh. Next time you are yelling at your children, just imagine Jesus doing that. Could you imagine Jesus yelling at kids, screaming at them? How about this? Let's work on undue severity, a punishment that does not fit the crime. Because when you do something like that, you're going to be driving your children further away from you than you realize.
Right.
One day when they're older, you're going to wonder why they don't want to talk to you and they don't want to go to church.
Amen.
Cruelty. Fathers, sons, husbands, we come home, we kick the dog, we slam the door. We just generally can't handle ourselves. One time, you gotta be careful up here, right? You can't say too much sin about yourself. Refrigerator I used to have, and I had a bottle of water many years ago. And I took my water bottle, and I was so mad. And it was one of those Aquafina plastic bottles, and you know a fridge looks like, and it's got, you know, a handle for the freezer, and it's got a handle for the fridge, and the handle is just this weird little oblong shape. And I was so mad, and I could not control myself, and I was being very emotional. And I threw it, and so here's the fridge, and here's me, and I throw it as hard as I can. It hit the handle, and the bottle, it was God. It just went, whoop, 180. And so my wife was watching, and she goes, you know, she was a very godly woman. She didn't say, see, but, you know, she could have very godly, crazy woman. But I learned very quickly, and that is never going to get out of my mind, because it hit me right in the nose, and I lost control of myself. But let me tell you, it's terrible. Cruelty, kicking the dogs in the door, let's get it, and let's work. Let's work that out of our lives. Favoritism. That's probably not something that we necessarily think about, but favoritism. You know, you treat one kid better than another. Or a grandbaby, or you treat a niece or something because one of them acts better, because one of them has better, one of them looks better, whatever it is. Let me tell you, we got to get that out of there. We're provoking our children, those we love, those we know, to wrath when we do that. Suppression. Men, especially, it's hard for us to sometimes open up to our family, to our wives, to tell them things. It's hard for us to open up to one another. What do you want to talk to me about? You know, it's okay. All right, we can talk to one another. And let me tell you, here's the most underused man in the church is your pastor. You go to your pastor, and you go to him, and you say, I've got this. I want to open up to you about my family. I want to open up to you about my wife. I want to open up to you about my kids. And then that man loves you. What he's going to do is he's going to take this word right here and he's going to show you this is what God says about that. Let's pray together. Can I call you tomorrow? Can I pray some more? Can we go out to IHOP? Can I help you? Can I guide you? Can I show you what the word of God said? And man, I tell you, he is the most underused man in this church. We've got to use him. We've got to use our pastor.
Amen.
Sarcasm. Being generally rude. I mean, you're a grown man and you're going to be sarcastic to a child. We're just telling those children, as soon as they're 16, they're going to turn their backs on us, and they're going to go away. Sarcasm. Ridicule. Making fun of your child. Oof. Misuse of your authority. You know, the authority granted to you, husbands, fathers, sons, the authority, it mirrors God's authority. And that's what's part of being in your house, a mirror of God's authority in your home. Now, I'm trying to move fast. Ephesians chapter 6, in that last part. Verse 4, and you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the what? The nurture and the admonition of who?
The Lord.
Lord. That's right. That word nurture here means training. Bring up your kids and train them. Train them. You know Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. I'll start it. I know you guys know it. Train up a child in the way he should go.
Way to go.
when he is older,
shall
not depart. That's right. I'll read it one more time. We're going to say it together. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Guess what? That's in the Word of God. Guess what? That's in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. And guess what? That sounds like a promise to me. And if it's a promise from God, you could take it to the bank. You could take it to the bank twice on Sundays. Train up a child. That's our job. In such a day and an age as ours, training is the least of many parents' concerns. It's evident in society when we look at it and we see it. Your child needs strength to lean on. Your child needs a shoulder to cry on. And your child needs an example to learn from. Now, if you're not going to be those three things for your child, guess what? Your child's going to find those things somewhere else. If it's your daughter's going to find that in another man. A man who doesn't look at your daughter as something pure and something holy. He's going to look at her as a conquest. If you go out into the world and you're looking for whatever else it is, you're going to find it. And you're not going to find it in the right place. Because those things are to be you, parents. You are to be that shoulder to cry on. You are to be that strength for them. You are to be the spiritual leader. This is what they need. Fathers, mothers, children, listen. We need spiritual strength to lean on. We need physical strength to cry on. And an example of a spiritual leader to learn from. Say amen right there.
Amen.
Praise God. That's exactly what we need. And that's exactly why our community, that's exactly why Hampton, that's exactly why Peninsula Baptist is here. And that's exactly what we see out there. We have a guy living in a tent right here. Why? Because there was a failure in his life. And guess what? It was probably his parents. And here we are as parents. Guess what? We need to be those parents. We have got to be that spiritual strength. We have got to be that spiritual leader. We have to be physically strong to lead our families. That is our responsibility. Yeah. Ours. It's not the government's. It's not anybody else's. It is our responsibility to train our children.
Amen.
And finally, admonition. We raise them. We nurture them. We train them in nurture. We prepare them in nurture. And when they get out of line, we admonish them. We correct them. We redirect them. We reprove them. Reprove. We prove it again. This is what we believe. This is why we believe. We are, after all, parents. A story that I remind myself of when I get overwhelmed in the kids. When I get overwhelmed in my kids. My car broke down at Walmart. Fortunately, it was 300 yards away from my house at the time. And so I ran home, middle of the summer. My son is, Brody's probably 4. I grab my tools, because I know what I need to do. I need to go over there, I need to fix this thing. And so I run back, these 300 yards, middle of summer, and I'm working on the car. I get it started, but I know I have to charge the battery. So I'm gonna drive up and down Shillelagh Road, it's a 13-mile road. That's where we lived at the time. And so I pull out of the Walmart, I get it fixed, 20 minutes later, and I'm going down Shillelagh Road. We're the third house on the right at the time. And guess who's right next to that busy road with a screwdriver in his hand, just wanting to help Dad. And I slammed the brakes. I pulled over. I couldn't turn the car off. And I said, Brody, what are you doing? I said, Brody, you can't be out here because you could get hurt. But all that he wanted to do was help his dad. And that's what our kids are like. Man, all our kids want to do, they look up to you, they love you. They want to learn, they want to be just like you, right? And then we go and we yell at them. And we drive them away from ourselves. And we give God a terrible testimony by yelling and getting mad. I don't want to be like that.
Man.
I know you don't either. I know you don't either, but sometimes it's hard. Sometimes it's very hard, isn't it? Kids Sunday is a great idea. Amen?
Amen.
Kids Sunday, what a great idea. It really makes you appreciate that nursery worker. All the things. Now, I pray this. I pray that we can remember some of these instructions to us as parents and the children. Just what the Word of God has to say for us. Number one, that we should be obedient. Truly obedient. Remember those four things. That immediate, obey right away, respectful, we should be joyful, and complete in our obedience. We should be immediate in it, respectful, joyful, and complete in our obedience. And then number two, as parents, that we don't provoke our children to wrath through hypocrisy. Be in one way, and then be in another way. Let's just be one. Speaking of children, are you born again? Are you a son of God?
Man.
Are you willing to be obedient unto the Lord? May Maybe this morning, if you're not saved, today is the day. Get adopted into the family of God. If you are feeling a tug, a pull, maybe you feel a wrench inside your heart, you cannot battle God. You're not strong. That tug that you're feeling right now, maybe you come down to an altar like this, and you just do business with the Lord. You know, fight. Come and be obedient. You say, Lord, I just want to get this thing right. But Lord, I'm struggling with this. Maybe this morning you have been saved. You want to follow through with believer's baptism. Just to show the world that you are not ashamed to be numbered with Jesus. And possibly this morning you have been struggling with obedience in your life. With your parents, with your loved ones, maybe a boss. Come and get it settled with God right now. Cry out to Him. Make a promise that you will work on your obedience to those who have authority in our lives.
Amen.
John chapter 1, verse 12, you know it. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become sons of God. Amen. Praise God. We're all sons. We can all be adopted in that family of God. Let's pray.
Amen.
Dear Lord, right now, we come to You, Lord, as sons. Maybe not, maybe we're unsaved right now, but Lord, we want to be saved. We cry out to You now, Lord. I know I'm a sinner. I know that You paid that price on the cross, Lord. You paid for my sin debt. Lord, I'm asking You to save me right now. There's nothing that I can do to ever earn it. Lord, please save me. I'm not trusting in anything that I could ever do. I'm only trusting in Your sacrificial payment on the cross. Thank You for it, Lord. Lord, maybe it's not that I need to get saved, but that I need to get baptized. Salvation, the first thing we should do, we should get baptized, Lord. If anybody wants to get baptized right now, if they just made their way up here and they wanted to get baptized, praise God. Maybe it's not that. Maybe you want to make your way up to this altar right now. And we just simply have 2 minutes of quietness where we do business with You, God, and we just tell You in what exactly we want to be obedient in. Let's start that 2 minutes right now. Just have a quiet moment.
pastors, you know, I read a thing, it was a blog a couple months ago, but, you know, right now it's very popular in our society to be a dog mom, or a cat mom, or a dad mom, or a dad cat mom, dad dog, dad one, whatever that is, right? And honestly, whenever I see stuff like that, now you may refer to yourself as a mom dog or whatever, dog mom, whatever that is. I've said it backwards, but you may refer to yourself as that. Forgive me here, okay? Forgive me. I'm not trying to be mean, not at all. But you're not a mom. You're not a dad of that dog or cat. That's totally unpopular. People may throw stones at me when I walk out of this building, but you're only a mom and a dad when it comes to kids.
Amen.
And you don't see anything in the Bible about teaching and training your cats in the admonition of the Lord.
Amen.
Or dogs.
Amen.
You see that with kids.
Amen.
You see the children.
Yeah.
You see the Bible to teach to have kids, to have children. What has our culture done today? Well, Japan. Man, if you read about Japan, they're having a horrible time right now with the decrease of population.
Yep.
And it has affected them horribly. There's no one to work. It's over, 70% of people who work right now are like over 60 years old. And who's going to work?
Yeah.
No one. When that's gone, no one. And Japan is going to be in a horrible mess. In America right now, you have big problem with that too. It's horrible. The Bible teaches moms, dads, have kids.
Yeah.
And I want to encourage you, don't just have a kid. It says kids.
Yeah.
The Bible says kids. Have more than one. I think a child doesn't need just one. I don't think there just needs to be one kid. I think that kid needs a brother.
Amen.
That
Amen.
Kid needs a sister.
Amen.
And it doesn't need a cat. Man, have you ever seen house hunters before? I get so mad, I want to throw the remote at the TV, because this couple, they'll be going through, look at this house, and they'll say, I hope Sammy likes this. Then they buy this house, and there's Sammy's dog.
Yeah.
That dog doesn't care.
Right.
It just wants to find a corner to pee on.
Yeah.
That's all it wants. Right? It doesn't care at all. No kids.
Amen.
That's where it's at.
Amen.
As the kids these days say.
Amen.
That's where it's at. And that's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible promotes. Have kids. Spend time with kids. They are a blessing. They sure can make you want to grit your teeth sometime. But they are a blessing.
Amen.
And you know, you can grit your teeth at them all you want, but they still come back at you and they love you.
Amen.
And man, it can make you want to tear up a little bit. But that's good. Amen. All right. 12:33. Now, there was a winning team. Okay, there was a winning team. Winning side. We're all on the winning side. Amen. If you're saved. But there is a winning side. And the winning side, Brother Mike, can you come up here for me?
Oh, boy.
Brother Mike, can you turn around and look at everyone? I turn back, look at me. Turn back, look at everyone. I'm sorry. Your side won right there. Won that quiet seat side. Good job to them. A round of applause. They did a good job. Now, here's the thing. I noticed there's only six things. Like, there's only six judges in each. So, preferably kids first, okay? But Brother Mike is going to pass that out to that side, okay? Now, there are three quiet seat prizes, though. Three quiet seat prizes. And I was... Oh, yeah, you're good. But I was looking for people who stay seated, right? Not necessarily coming and going and we're doing a good job paying attention and listening and watching. And so there's obviously three people here, right? Three people to pick. I have three people that I picked up. They did a good job. One of them was Brother Samuel over here.
Hey.
He did an awesome job. Brother Samuel, you get your pick. Which one do you want? Or I can throw it to you. Kids versus Souls. And then I also saw Brody. Hey. Brody, you did a good job. Brody, you want M&M? Which one do you want? Good job, Brody. And then the last person, like I said, I was looking for people who didn't come and go, right? That's what I was looking for. The last person I saw was Felicity Whitehouse. So good job. Brother Justin, did you pray? Then we'll be dismissed.
Of course. Good Lord, thank you.